ever feel alone? Like an outsider looking in? Wishing someone would care? Jesus cares, and so do we, the people of Heritage International Christian Church.
All right, if you have your Bibles this morning, go with me to Ephesians chapter 5. We're going to start at verse 14. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 14. This morning I want to pray with you. Those of you who are here and you say, I don't understand a lot about how to have a relationship with God, but I want to. So I want to get a chance to pray with you this morning. And then those of you who are here and you say, well, I want a relationship with God, I want to pray with you also. And then those of you who are here and you say, well, you know, I don't know a lot about that, but I just know I just need help, I want to get a chance to pray with you also. But before we do, I want us to just talk some this morning. And I want to start in Ephesians chapter 5. If you have that, Ephesians 5, starting at verse 14, would you stand with us? We stand in honor of God and his written word. We believe that the Bible is the word of God, and therefore we stand out of respect for the reading. John chapter 5, starting at verse 14. Right, what did I say?
John.
Are y'all trying to say I said John?
Yes.
How did y'all know it was Ephesians? How many people think I said John? We're in Ephesians chapter 5, and we're going to start at verse 14, and I'm going to read it in King James Version. Wherefore he saith, awake, thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. And be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God, and the Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Just before you're seated, would you, as we customarily do sometimes, give a couple people a high five and tell them it's all about him. It's all about Jesus. It's all about him. You've heard the phrase before, fight for your relationship. Amen. Today we want to talk about fighting for your relationship, but fighting for your relationship with God. It's important in the days that we live that we fight for our relationship with God. Now, let's go over to Revelation. Let's go back over there and see something about this. Revelation chapter 12. Your relationship with God is the most important thing in your life. If you have God, now think of this. God, when I say God, I'm talking about the one who created everything. When you have God on your side, it doesn't matter who is your enemy. Because God is bigger than everybody. So when God, when you know that you have a relationship with God, it's like, you know, when you back at home, if you messed with, there were certain families you just didn't mess with. Because if you messed with one, you know, the one in my grade, you messed with him, you got to mess with all of his brothers. And all of them were older than us. And so that's the way it is with God. When you know that God is for you, then everything else that tries to come against you doesn't really matter. You can have confidence that God's going to bring you out. So I said that to say it's important. Your relationship with God, your connectedness, how connected do you feel to God? That's the key thing. How connected do you feel to God? Do you feel like God is a million miles away? Do you feel like God comes whenever you want? You feel like God is right there? Even when you're asleep, he's watching. How close do you feel he is to you? How important are you to him in your mind? Because see, if you don't think you're important to him, you won't bother him. Until it's really, 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 really something that you can't handle. And a lot of people think that that's what God wants. God, a lot of people think that God wants them to just leave me alone. God's up here. I'm busy. Would you try to handle it till I, if you can't handle it, then call me. And that's the way a lot of people think God is. So what do you think about your relationship with God? You're going to have to fight for it. I said, you're going to have to fight for it. It's got to be so important to you that you're willing to fight for it. Look here, Revelation chapter 12. Did I tell you to go there? Yeah, y'all trying to play with me, but I know what I said. Revelation chapter 12. Watch this. There was war in heaven, verse 7. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought against the angels and prevailed not, neither was their place, verse 8, found anymore in heaven. Verse 9, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice, verse 10, saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night, and they overcame him. Verse 11. By the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Now, this is talking about two things, two events, actually. The first event that it's talking about in verse 9, where the devil was cast out. Say, cast out. Yes. He was cast out of heaven. The devil was an angel. He was actually one of the archangels. A very important angel, and some believe he led the worship in heaven, but he became so obsessed with himself that he felt like he needed to be worshiped. And when he did that, the Bible says he was cast out. Say, cast out. Yes. So now notice here, notice in verse 9, the great dragon was what? He was, say it again, cast out. That old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world, he was what?
Cast out.
Cast out. So the first time in verse 9 says he was cast out. Then the second time it says he was cast out into the earth. And then his angels were what?
Cast
out with him. Cast out. Say that word again. Cast out. Those two words. So you see, he was cast out of heaven. So when he talks about being cast out, he's talking about the devil being cast out of heaven. You got that part? Okay, so that's important. But then, now in the next verse, it says, I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation. What, now, when did salvation come? There you go, Vince. Say that again. When Jesus went to the cross, that's when salvation came. Notice what it says. Now it's come salvation and strength and what? The kingdom of God and the power of his Christ. When did all of that come? When Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead. These are two different events. The first event was when the devil was cast out. He was cast out from heaven. Are you with me?
Yes.
This is important that you get this. But now let's look at the next event. He says, now has come salvation and strength, the kingdom of a God and the power of his Christ. Now for the accuser of our brethren is what?
Yes.
Cast what?
Yes.
Cast down. Not cast out. He said cast out. But then he said cast down. See, when God kicked him out of heaven, he was cast out. But when we put him under our feet, he's cast down. See, the Bible says that he is the prince of the power of the air. When he came into the earth, he took up leadership in the atmosphere of the earth. But when God saved us and strengthened us and the power of his Christ has come, now he expects us to cast him.
Wow.
That's our destiny. We are destined to put evil under our feet. We're not destined to sin all the time. We may miss it. You know, we miss it every once in a while. But our destiny is to put sin and evil under our feet.
Amen.
Say, cast down. Now, who was cast down? The devil, which, verse 10, accused them before God day and night. The devil has been accusing you to God until God took care of that. See, why was the devil accusing you to God? Have you ever had anybody, talking about you?
Yes.
You know, maybe, I don't know if you've ever been in that situation, but, you know, I've been, you know, a chaplain, and so I heard a whole lot. She said, and he said, and then they get all in the mix, and then they come to see me. And sometimes it boils down to, what she said, what she told him about her. In other words, what her best friend, wife's best friend, told the husband about the wife. Now think with me, why would the wife's best friend be telling the husband something negative about the wife? Can you think of why that might happen? And vice versa. I've seen it work in both ways. But the idea is to separate those two so that somebody else can step in. See what that other woman, say other woman. What the other woman had, and you gotta watch who your friends are. You gotta really know who your friends are. That other woman, say
the other woman.
What that other woman has to do, she has to get you not to trust your husband. Is that right? Because once she's able to break the trust between you, there's a wedge in the relationship. In other words, there's an alleyway. There's a way for someone to get in. Well, that's what the devil has been doing ever since Adam and Eve sinned. He would accuse you. The Bible says he accused them to God to try to get God not to trust you. But that's not all. He come running to you. And he accused God to you. He'll make you think that God's your enemy. That God killed somebody. You know, God took your baby, or God took your mama, or God made you sick. He's going to accuse God to you so that he can make a wedge in your relationship so he can step right in. Now, God, you got to get a hold of this, because just write this in your notes there. God never stopped trusting you. God, no matter what the devil says about you, God still trusts you. God still has confidence in you. How do I know? Pastor, how do you know that? Because God never takes away from you your free will. God always allows you the option whether to choose, because he has trust and confidence. He's made up his mind that he will always trust you. So you always have the option whether to choose to love him or to leave him. He's going to always keep you free to make that choice because he trusts you. Now, when Satan tempted Adam and Eve, the devil, he would say, did God say you shouldn't eat of that? Yeah, the Lord said, Eve would say, well, God said, don't even touch it, because if we do, we'll die. Here's where he goes. He goes, you shall not really die, but God knows that when you eat of it, you're going to become like him. And so now Eve starts thinking, wow, God's holding out on me. Eve stopped trusting God. God never stopped trusting Eve. God never stopped trusting man. But people stopped trusting God. And that is the breach. That's the separation. That's why people don't have relationship with God. Because people don't trust God. Does that make sense? So, notice what it says. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. This is the salvation. Now is salvation. Now is come what? Salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. When? When God fought for your relationship. On the cross, the Bible says, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, that, watch this, God was in Christ on the cross fighting for your relationship. God was in Christ on the cross, the Bible says it this way, reconciling. That's a relationship word. You were gone somewhere. I didn't want nothing to do with God. I didn't want to think about God. But God was on the cross fighting for our relationship. But it takes two. He was in Christ fighting for our relationship. God did his part. Then the rest of that scripture says, now be ye reconciled. In other words, now, won't you fight for your relationship with God? I'm going to just let that sink in. Someone asked me, what are we going to do? There's so many bad things happening, so much going on. What are we going to do? Here's what we're not going to do. we're not going to let go of our relationship with God. We're not going to let the devil, no matter what's going on around us, no matter how bad things get or what's lost, or it doesn't matter what happens, we have to be committed. I have to be committed. I'm not going to let go of God. Because as long as I have God, I can always rise again. Are you with me? As long as you hold on to your relationship with God, you can always rise again. You can always bounce back. You can always come up. So what's the devil want to do? He wants to do the same thing he's always wanted to do. He wants to separate you from God. He wants to get you so worried, so uptight, so thinking about bad things that you separate, you don't cling to God. Okay, so what are we going to do? Let's go to Ephesians now. Ephesians, back over there, Ephesians chapter 5. This is what we're going to do. And it doesn't matter what your situation is. You may say, well, the devil's attacking me in one area, or the devil's attacking me in another area. Whatever it is, we're going to hold on to our relationship with God. Ephesians chapter 5. Back over here at verse 14. Wherefore he saith, awake, thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are what?
Evil.
The days are what?
Evil.
These are some evil days that we live in. No peace, no rest. People talk about these as rough times. But now the Lord had already told us, 2011, that 2012 was going to be okay, but when 2013 came in, he told us that 2013 was going to begin some hard times. Wow. It's going to be the beginning of hard times. How many people remember this? Amen. Now here's the thing. All throughout the Bible, there have been good times and bad times. But when people held on to God, they came through with victory all the time. In the good or in the bad, anybody that had a relationship with God, God was a provider and a father. He was a protector and a keeper. But it depends on whether you hold on to your relationship or not. That's why the devil, he's got to get your relationship from God. He's got to get you mad at God. He's got to get you separated from God. He's got to get you thinking about something else other than God, because if he can't get your mind off of God, he can't get you. So what are we going to do? Well, Fort Knox, they're all talking about, you know, what's going to happen to Fort Knox and what's going to happen to all of our jobs there. What, you know, these are serious issues. What's going to happen with these nations that we've allowed to just break all up, and now they got terrorists off, and we're going to have to go to war here, and we're going to be at war. These are serious issues. What's going to happen with all of the droughts and the floods start coming again and all the fire stuff? And then when they start the chicken flus and all the swine flu, and these are serious issues. When everybody else is talking about how bad things are, what are we going to do? Somebody's got to see. They're waiting to see what a Christian does. They're waiting to see what a believer does. They're waiting to see with somebody who's connected with God. What do you do? Well, here's what we do. Verse 16, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Verse 17, wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. What is God's will? What does he want us to do? Verse 18, be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess. Now this is something you got to know. In the days to come, as more and more pressure, you know, more and more bad news comes out, there's going to be more and more access to stimulants, to drugs, to alcohol. There are going to be more and more people getting drunk, more and more people getting high. And people are going to still be talking about, oh, we don't, how, why can't we stop it? We can't stop it. We got this commission on crime. But nothing's working. How is it that nothing works? Well, anyways, we don't have to go there. But the point is, you're going to find more and more medicated peoples. He says, be not drunk with wine or medication, wherein is what?
Excess.
But be filled with the Spirit. That's what we're going to do. In the midst of everything that's going on, we're going to be filled with the Spirit. Say that with me. Be filled with the Spirit. Say it again. Be filled with the Spirit. Say it again. Be filled with the Spirit. That's what we're going to do. We're going to be filled with the Spirit. And in this text, in the Greek, this word be filled is in the present tense. And in the present tense Greek, it denotes continuous action. So in other words, he's saying be being filled. Don't just be filled one time, but be continuously filled. Don't be filled with wine wherein is excess, or medication, or drugs, or whatever they're going to give you to kind of medicate you while they take all your world away. But be filled with the Spirit. Be being filled continuously.
Amen.
Someone said, well, how do we do that?
We're so glad that you tuned into this program today. We want you to know that God is not your problem. God is not mad at you. God loves you. That's why he's had us to come to you to bring this message. Because he wants you to know, not only does he love you, but you are special to him. God wants you to know he cares about what you're going through. I want to pray with you now. And when we pray, I believe a miracle is going to happen in your life. Let's pray together. Father God, I pray for my friends right now. I pray that they'll get the revelation, that they'll get the understanding that you are their friend, that you're not their problem. I pray that they'll call on you. I pray that they'll reach out for your love. I'm praying that their faith will go out toward you and they will be blessed this week. Thank you, Father, for blessing my friends this week. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, and we'll see you next week.
Does God care about the unemployed who need to feed their families? Does God care about teenagers in trouble? Does God care that our homeless community is growing? Does God care that terrorists are trying to destroy our country? Does God care about the drug and alcohol addicts? Does God care about me? Yes, God cares about you. A message from your friends at Heritage International Christian Church.